Welcome to Day's video. We're gonna watch more Kurzgesagt. We're gonna watch more Kurzgesagt and talk about physics and science. Make sure you subscribe. Go sign up for CalVPN. What else is there to say? Don't go anywhere. Watch the whole video. That's enough horsing around. Let's get into it. The black hole bomb and black hole civilizations. There's lots of cool stuff we can talk about here. We'll see what he talks about. You might have noticed by some of my videos, it's like some I talk more, some I talk less. It really depends how tired I am. And I kind of go, like one video, I'll talk a bit more about science, and then the next one I'll, you know, just watch a bit more, just so you guys, I don't know, I like to try and balance it out. That's what I've seemed to have fallen into that. Anywho, let's do it.
Black holes are the largest collections of pure, violent energy in the universe.
That's a good one. Speaking of pure, violent energy, let me just get something for you. This is Cygnus. Say hello, Cygnus.
Hello. Meow.
The one and only. But anyway, I named him Cygnus after the closest black hole because he's a violent little creature. And so, yeah, I thought that was fitting. But anyway, let's get back to the video. I just wanted to show everyone my cat. I think he's going to stay here on my lap now.
Meow.
He's probably going to give me hay fever. Oh dear, he's trying to attack my headphones now. Might have to kick him out. Get out of here. If you've been watching for a while, you would have actually met him. I've introduced him before. But anyway, let's go back to the video. Black hole being Pac-Man.
If you come too close...
That is a duck around a black hole.
Add your energy to their collection.
Okay.
And so, the energy is lost to us forever. Or is it...
Yeah, that's... You know, that's not exactly...
It turns out there's a universe cheat code. A way of powering civilizations until the very death of everything, or of constructing the largest bomb in the universe. But how? Didn't we learn that all energy is trapped forever in black holes, even light? This is true. Everything...
That's not true. So there's something called the black hole information paradox. That's right, paradox, because there's a problem with black holes, with our current understanding of physics, and that is... You know, like, if black holes are consuming all of this information, all this energy and matter, and then, you know, with what we know about Hawking radiation, which inevitably leads to black holes evaporating, you know, in a very long time span, well, you know, if black holes took in this information and they disappear, it's like, where did that information go? So why is this a problem? Because of the conservation of energy. That, you know, we've never seen that broken before. And that is something that, you know, all other physics, the rest of our physics kind of sits on, you know, and this black hole information paradox kind of violates that in a huge way. You know, it's, the information just disappears. Everything else in the universe is just recycled energy, you know, like everything in your body, all the energy, all of it comes from, you know, somewhere else in the universe. It hasn't been created or destroyed. Like you probably know, you were made out of star stuff. You know, like most of the heavy elements have been produced at the cores of massive dying stars. So, yeah, if you didn't know that, and your right hand probably is made of different star stuff to your left hand. Wild stuff. Anyway, where was we going with this? I reckon we get back to the video about now. I was talking about the information paradox. And you'll see information constantly, you know, like articles about how we've solved the paradox. And take all of those with a grain of salt. You know, it's theoretical physics. You've got to take all of that with a hefty grain of salt. Why? Because, you know, we don't have an experimental laboratory right now. We don't have a black hole to play with. So there's really no way of verifying this stuff. You know, sure, you know, we've got math and we can prove stuff with math, but it doesn't, we still need experiments to validate objective reality, right? We might have a black hole to play with one day, I'm sure, but not right now. So, you know, I don't think it's actually solved. But anyway, let's get back to the video. I'm talking too much.
You think you know about the weirdest thing in the universe is about to get weirder for one simple reason. Black holes are spinning.
Mm. So I'm sure he's going to talk about it, but this, what does that mean, like, for a black hole to spin? Well, it actually means, like, it drags the fabric of reality, the fabric of space-time around with it as they spin. It's wild. It's called frame dragging.
Why black holes spin?
Because everything spins.
When really, really massive
conservation of angular momentum
stars die, their cores collapse under their own gravity into black holes. This means something very big becomes very, very tiny. Like the tiniest anything can be in this universe. But stars are rotating, and a fundamental property of our universe is that things that are spinning don't want to stop spinning. We call this angular momentum. And this angular momentum can't go away. A big thing that spins and becomes smaller spins faster. So, as the core of a star collapses, its momentum makes it spin faster and faster and faster until it collapses into a black hole. And the black hole keeps on spinning, inconceivably fast. Some of them spin millions of times a second.
Mm-hmm.
Why spinning black holes are special? Just like non-spinning black holes, spinning black holes have an event horizon and a singularity at their core where all of their mass is concentrated. The singularity...
That's, you know, like hypothetical. We don't know that for sure. Just want to point that out there.
...is usually described as a single...
When I say hypothetical, I meant theoretical.
...infinitely small point with no surface area. But points can't rotate, so a rotating singularity can't be a point. Instead, it's a ringularity. A ringularity is a ring with a thickness of zero and no surface, spinning extremely fast, containing all the mass of the black hole. The black hole is spinning so fast that it morphs space and time itself. It literally drags space with it, such is its power. This creates a new ergosphere, which envelops the black hole. If space and time are completely broken inside the event horizon, then they're only half broken inside the ergosphere. Inside the ergosphere, nothing makes sense. It's possible to enter it and then leave it again, but it's probably not a great experience. You can imagine it like this. Falling into a static black hole is like sliding down a hole. Being inside the ergosphere of a spinning black hole is like spiraling down a deadly drain. The black hole transfers its own kinetic energy in the form of rotation to everything that enters the ergosphere. The ringularity makes you dance, whether you want to or not. You need to move faster than the speed of light just to stand still here, which is impossible. But here's our cheat code. We can steal this energy. And there's a lot of energy to steal.
There's so many interesting things we could do with black holes. Like, we could actually use them to propel our spaceships, right? If you shot a laser around a black hole, I'm sure you know that, you know, black holes can warp light and they bring it back on themselves. And so you could shoot this laser and it would go all the way around. And, you know, if you put like a mirror or something on your spaceship, well, you could propel it like a light sail. So you could get your spaceships to relativistic speeds like fairly easily. And I remember reading Kip Thorne worked out, the guy who won the Nobel Prize a few years back. Amazing guy. He's the guy who helped write Interstellar, by the way. He worked out that you could actually accelerate spaceships with the mass of Jupiter still to relativistic speeds, which is crazy. And so you can imagine in the far future, or aliens doing this right now, they could be using black holes as like galactic waypoints. You could use these binary galaxy systems, you know, ones that are dancing together, to basically launch yourselves around the universe. So I imagine there's probably super advanced civilizations out there right now doing this. And we might actually be able to detect aliens by looking for specific signs with these with binary black holes, because if there are civilizations out there doing this, what we would notice is that these binary black holes are losing energy in a certain way. Like, they'd be losing too much energy, because what we would see is, well, basically these halo drives, they've been dubbed, would be exploiting energy from these binary black hole systems. And so we would see black holes emerging, binary systems emerging more often than we should. So that is a way to find aliens in the universe. And I think I forgot to mention, you'd need to be relatively close to these black holes for this halo drive to work. So if you're going to do it, you'd have to then, you know, launch yourself at another black hole. So you'd literally have to be just bunny hopping black holes all around the place. But there's something like, I think, 10 million estimated binary black hole systems in the Milky Way alone. So yeah, I think this is probably a likely future scenario to play out if we survive.
How to steal energy from a monster. Take the supermassive black hole at the center of the Milky Way. We could steal as much energy from it as every single star in the Milky Way emits in a billion years combined. The easiest way to steal this energy is, oddly enough, to drop something into the black hole. We've seen that the ringularity forces energy on us when we enter the ergosphere, which is a lot like being in a whirlpool with space-time rushing around and around. If you're clever, you can use the water to your advantage and swim faster than before. In practice, this means sending a rocket into the ergosphere and making a trade with the black hole. We give it some mass energy, and it gives us some of its rotational energy. But it's not a fair trade. We get the better deal. Normally, if you fire a rocket, you exchange chemical energy for kinetic energy. This is like pushing yourself forward in a swimming pool. But if you fire a rocket inside the ergosphere, it's like pushing yourself forward in a wave pool. The rotational energy of the waves gives you a much stronger boost than you could get just by pushing yourself. The boost from the rotation of the black hole is so big that you leave the ergosphere with much more energy than you entered it. The black hole gives a tiny amount of its rotational energy to you and slows down a little.
So I actually filmed this video a couple weeks ago, and after I filmed it, I started reading into just more of this stuff to update my understanding. And there's some really interesting stuff that has since come out, you know, since I last read about this stuff. And that video, Kurz Gazette posted, was in 2018. And in 2020, there was somewhat of an experimental validation of the Penrose process. Not that exact one, but like they did something analogous with sound waves and it worked. So that's pretty cool. It's, you know, we'd still have to test it with electromagnetic waves around black holes. We're nowhere near being able to do that, but it's still pretty cool to see that the effect that the Penrose process would rely on, in principle, you know, works. So yeah, I just wanted to add that onto the video. So, you know, you're going to be seeing me 2 weeks ago, but anyway, let's get into the video.
Obviously, this requires a lot of food. Fortunately, black holes aren't picky eaters. An advanced future civilization would probably harvest asteroids to drop them into the black hole when they needed an energy boost. But there's an even better way to get energy from a black hole, and oddly enough, it builds the biggest bomb any living thing could ever hope to build. The black hole bomb.
I don't know if he's going to talk about it, but it would actually be easier to get energy from a smaller black hole. And that's because smaller black holes release more intense Hawking radiation, which is counterintuitive. It comes out of the math. So these, like, if they exist, that is, you know, you've probably heard of like these small primordial black holes that can be, you know, like microscopic. Those ones, maybe not so much, but like, you know, a small baseball sized one releases a little bit smaller than that, actually. They release a fair amount of Hawking radiation, which you could potentially harness. And people have, in the theoretical physics area, have come up with a lot of ways to harness energy from black holes. And there's a lot of creative ideas, like, you know, obviously if you shoot a light around a black hole, it comes back, you know, if you do it right. And you can utilize that in lots of creative ways to, you know, create some kind of a perpetual like machine. Anyway, let's get back to the video because I think he's going to talk about this bomb and I want to see what he says.
We only need two things to build a black hole bomb: a fast spinning black hole and a big mirror. The mirror has to completely envelop the black hole, which is similar to a Dyson sphere, a megastructure that harvests the energy of an entire star. although our mirror would be easier to build. Mirrors are simpler, and black holes are much, much more compact than stars. If we made the mirror 10 centimeters thick, the metal of a big asteroid would probably be enough material for a black hole with the mass of our sun. Once our mirror is in place, we only need to open a window and shoot electromagnetic waves at the black hole. You can imagine what happens next by imagining tossing a ball at a wall and it coming back faster than a bullet. The waves...
If you didn't know, when he said electromagnetic waves, that is just light.
...the black hole at light speed. A small proportion of the waves falls past the event horizon to disappear forever. But a much larger amount sloshes through the ergosphere, where the black hole forces some of its rotational energy on them and amplifies them. They now begin super radiant scattering, which are fancy science words meaning bouncing around between mirror and black hole and getting stronger. Every time they go around, they are getting exponentially stronger. By opening some windows in the mirror, we can extract the energy from the waves as fast as they grow, which we could use, in theory, to create what would be, for all practical purposes, an endless source of energy for trillions of years. Or we could blow
it up.
Well,
not endless. Yeah.
If the waves are not released, they will continue to get stronger and stronger and take more and more energy from the black hole until the mirror shatters. A supermassive black hole would release as much energy as a supernova, making the bomb the largest explosion any living being could ever create. The last home in a dying universe. The beauty of the black hole,
create bigger ones, actually.
Bomb, the Penrose process, and the super radiant scattering is that they are not science fiction. In the far, far future, this might be the only way to survive in our dying universe. After all the red dwarfs have cooled down and all the white dwarfs transformed into black dwarfs, the universe will turn dark forever. Rotating black holes...
That's if our current understanding of, you know, which way the universe is going ends up coming into fruition. You know, you've probably heard of the heat death of the universe. That might not happen, you know. So anyway.
Might be the only sources of energy in the entire universe that life could harvest. If so, the last living being in existence might one day end its life around a black hole, which is equally chilling and uplifting. It turns out that even without any light, there are places we can go.
Unless we're all just, you know, the imagination of a Boltzmann brain that's already floating around in just the void, and we're just the random, you know, quantum field fluctuations that, you know, popped, that spawned this Boltzmann brain spontaneously. This is like how to steal energy from a monster. To how to trap a monster, then feed it stuff so it will give us energy. That is, yeah, pretty much what you're doing. Making light from absolute darkness. That's really impressive. Absolute darkness. I guess. This may be our last hope. Maybe, but I'm certain I want those other humans over there dead. Yeah, we'd still find ways to kill each other. I love humanity. We look at a black hole, an infinitely dense point, this theoretical, that consumes everything that comes near it forever. No, we have no idea what happens, and it is basically the scariest thing in the universe. We look at that and think, yeah, we could get energy from that. Yeah, that's a good point. I love how humans' first thoughts are always, how can I weaponize this?
You better sign up for KelBPN, or I will... not like you.
Thanks for watching, guys. Hope you enjoyed. Make sure you subscribe. I'll catch you next time.